redemption.
If you're a victim of abuse, you're not guilty. You haven't done anything wrong, but redemption is not just from our own mistakes, it's also from the evil that's been done to us. To go from my world is safe and I am safe to my world is unsafe, I don't know who I can trust, at any time I can be hurt again, and to feel so alone.
It's not that we feel safe, it's just that we know what the outcome is going to be. I know this, so that's what I'm going to follow.
There's gaslighting making you doubt your own perspective until they are in control. And at a certain point, you look at the person who hurt you and you see them as pathetic and you see them as beneath you.
You're going to be okay. There's things to look forward to and you get to be safe.
For you to heal and to take the reins of your life again, you're going to have to find people you can trust.
Hey everybody, little trigger warning, we are talking about Mad Max Fury Road, Furiosa and the Brides. We're going to be discussing sexual abuse and trauma. It's not depicted in the film, we're not going to show any depictions of it, but we are going to be discussing that. If that's triggering for you, you may want to skip this one and check out one of our other episodes.
Or watch this with a friend to help you through it because you may need to hear the message.
Correct.
But your call. Hello and welcome to Cinema Therapy. I'm Jonathan Decker, licensed therapist, and I love movies.
I'm Alan Seawright, professional filmmaker who needs therapy.
And joining us today is Dr. Imani Walker, who I am seriously fanboying right
I'm
now.
I'm fanboying myself. Like, and it's incredible.
And so is everyone in the edit bay, by the way. Everyone over there is just geeking out because they think you're a goddess.
I will neither confirm nor deny the facts of that story.
Thank you for having me. My name is Dr. Imani Walker, as you said. I first learned of Cinema Therapy through someone let me know on Instagram. And ever since then, I've been a huge fan.
You are the medical director of the Gateways Hospital and Mental Health Center in Los Angeles. You're the star of the reality show Married to Medicine. And you have been featured in so many outlets I can't even keep track of. But your areas of specialty are, I mean, you're a psychiatrist. It is mental health. And today we're going to be covering recovering from sexual trauma through the lens of Furiosa and the Brides in Mad Max Fury Road. So he keeps his brides in a safe. That's not possessive. But it's nice in there, as safes go.
Well, it's a vault to keep, they have filtered air to keep them safe from all the whatever. Our babies will not be warlords.
Who killed the world?
Every inch of this movie is...
They are not your property!
It's jam-packed with details and world-building.
Sooner or later, someone pushes back!
Where is she taking them?
She didn't take them! They begged her to go!
Where is she taking them?
A long way from you!
Did that not sound like Bane to anyone else?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah, I mean, I know, like, the same actor who played Bane is in this movie. So, I mean, my first thought was, I was like, I really love your pandemic mask. Like, you're really killing it right now.
No one cared who I was till I put on the mask.
I was like, wait a second. I was like, that's Bane. I was like, this is the same person.
Immortan Joe is a narcissist. I mean, he tells the people, yeah. He calls himself basically their savior.
I am your redeemer!
And that they need to be reliant on him. And you could see that with his brides. A lot of times in sexually abusive relationships, there is a cycle of punishment and then rewards, right? I own you, you will do what I want, but if you do what I want, things will go better for you, right? But then Miss Giddy is saying, people are not property, right? You can't own people. Sooner or later, someone pushes back. What are your thoughts, Dr. Walker, on the narcissism of sexual abusers?
It's really interesting because I've actually been talking to a few patients recently, and some of these people had told me, well, not some of them, all of them had told me, oh, like I now am acknowledging the fact that I was an abuse survivor because, like you said, the narcissistic nature, it's very, it's insidious. And to the point where even like the victim doesn't know that it's going on because it's not like, oh, you wake up one day and then all of a sudden you're in a cave with a chandelier. with, you know, some guy who sounds like Bane. It's this very stepwise, methodical, the abusers will start to like literally shut these people off from the outside world. In a lot of cases, when you first meet someone who's very narcissistic, you may be like, oh, you know what? Like, this person's just really like confident.
Yeah.
And after a while, it's like they say things and you're coming, you as like just, you know, a regular person are viewing this narcissist as someone who is quote unquote normal. And so you're giving them the benefit of the doubt. And so when they start to do more and when they start to do things that are more and more wild and more abusive, you're like, oh, well, that's just Joe, you know, like, he walks around like, you know, with that crazy mask on. But I mean, girl, that's just how he acts. Like, don't even
like roided out Skeletor.
I can't take much more of this.
He tells us to call him Immortan. That's fine. Like, right, he's just a little weird.
There's gaslighting, making you doubt your own perspective until they are in control. And people see it from the outside and they say, this is an abusive relationship. The same way if I don't see my friend's kid for a year and then I go over for a barbecue and I say, you've grown so much. And the parents go, oh, has he?
Hey there, Forrest. Goo goo gaga.
You know, because they haven't noticed it's so gradual over time. A friend can say, you're in an abusive relationship. It's, am I? Huh. I hadn't really seen.
Interesting. Yeah. Right. Like I live in a cave. Like, what's the big deal? Right. And it's like, girl, you live in a cave.
It feels normal.
like what do you like? I don't live in a cave.
We have Furiosa, who she's more metaphorically representing sexual abuse. We don't know that she has been sexually abused. That's never addressed. But she was taken, like the brides, and made to do things against her will that she now regrets. And in her case, it was to be a lieutenant, a war lieutenant, and to do all sorts of horrific things.
Well, it's also strongly implied that she was one of Immortan Joe's breeders and wasn't able to give him a son.
Mm.
And instead of just getting thrown out, she proved herself as a warrior to become one of his imperators. This episode is sponsored by Surfshark.
Surfshark is a VPN, a virtual private network. It'll protect your security online.
Better than a convoy of war boys.
Which is great, but we're excited to use it to access different content libraries so we can watch more movies and TV shows.
And not have to go mad that you can't watch them in the United States or the Citadel.
If you're traveling, like, say, through a desert wasteland or a toxic storm, you can change your virtual location and still connect to all your favorite websites.
Surfshark also helps keep you safe on public Wi-Fi, so if you're traveling or on the road, even the Fury Road, you can stay safe on any public network.
Surfshark encrypts your online data, protecting you on public Wi-Fi. But does it protect you from Immortan Joe?
Probably. They do have 24/7 support and a cookie pop-up blocker.
Ooh, cookies!
Not these cookies. They were made by the People Eater.
Get Surfshark VPN at surfshark.deals/cinematherapy and enter promo code
CINEMATHERAPY
for 83% off and 3 extra months for free.
Thanks, Surfshark, for awaiting us at the gates of Valhalla.
What a lovely day.
What a lovely day.
How does it feel?
It hurts.
Out here, everything hurts. You want to get through this? Do as I say. Now pick up what you can and run.
One thing that our associate producer, Sophie, pointed out that's really interesting about this film is we have these women who have been, you know, sexualized and brutalized. Because of that, they're put in wardrobe that is very revealing.
Yeah.
Obviously, Charlize Theron is one of the most beautiful women on the planet, and none of them are shot in the stereotypical sort of male gaze, like fetishization of body parts way.
Even though they're dressed for character purposes as sexualized objects because that's how Immortan Joe had them.
Yeah.
The film doesn't...
The film does
they're
not...
They're not filmed that way.
They're not exploited. Like, the film is not about exploiting them that way. The film is showing that the character, Immortan Joe, was exploiting them that way.
It is interesting to see how they're dressed now. Like, they all kind of look like they were either in, like, an Obsession commercial from back in the day.
Obsession.
Uh-huh.
Or they were, like, on a runway, you know, recently. Yeah. The way that they're shot... Even though, I mean, and they're just walking around, right? Like, they're not, it's clear that they're not being told, like, okay, well, like, suck in your stomach and, like, arch your back and, like, you know, make sure that you're, you know, in enticing, you know, poses.
Yeah. I want to talk about the words, out here, everything hurts.
Yeah.
And then she says, pick up what you can and run. And for sexual abuse survivors, everything hurts. I mean, yes, literally physically, but also emotionally, spiritually, mentally, psychologically. It is to go from my world is safe and I am safe to my world is unsafe. I don't know who I can trust. At any time, I can be hurt again, you know, and to see shadows in every corner and to feel so alone like that. It takes survival, emotional, psychological survival takes a lot of grit. And Furiosa is protecting the brides and she's out for the brides to help them, but she is not... At any given moment, she's not especially nurturing.
No, it doesn't seem to be in her nature very much.
This entire film, every character who's not Immortan Joe was victimized by Immortan Joe in some way or another.
Yeah.
And so all of these, the brides and Knox and Max and Furiosa, none of them know how to do anything but gritty survivalism. And so it's all about, this entire film is about them coming to understand how to show compassion, right? Mm-hmm. And what that looks like. There's a tendency to drift back into an abusive situation because you've been told for so long that you can't survive without the abuser. So let's take a look at that.
Gino! Gino, don't be stupid! Stop! He'll forgive us!
I know he will!
There's no going back!
We were his treasures!
Gino! We were protected! He gave us the high life! What's wrong with that?
We are not things!
No! Cheeto, we are not things!
We are not things!
I don't want to hear that again!
They were her words!
And now she's dead!
Bring your hand and tear your hair, but you're not going back.
You're not going back to him!
And hurry!
If you're leaving an abusive relationship and you still feel a connection to your abuser, you know?
Sure.
Because those feelings, even if you rationally know it was an abusive relationship, even if you know that you're better off without that person, the attachment is still there.
Well, and the good times can play an outsized role in your memory and
yeah,
all that.
Yeah,
right?
Absolutely. Yeah. And you can, and it can be scary to be on your own, especially if the person was convincing you that you can't survive on your own, right? And so you...
Yeah.
And so I think we all need a friend or an ally to say...
to have a large caliber rifle.
People do what they know. They don't do what... And this goes for everybody. Me, you, your dog, everybody. It's you do what you know. And it takes a lot of time and reconditioning and strength, as we call it, to do the opposite, because the opposite is something that is unknown and in a lot of regards is untrusted. And if you don't have a basis for like, okay, if I do the opposite, I'm going to be safe. It's safety is in a lot of times, it's not that we feel safe. It's just that we know what the outcome is going to be. Even if it means that you get your ass beat, even if it means that like you end up being like, raped, even if it means that like, you know, you wake up in a cave in a, you know, under lock and key. It's like, I know this. So that's what I'm going to follow, as opposed to, no, girl, like you have to come with us. Like, we don't know what's on the other side, but we know it's not going to be that.
Yeah. And that it's gonna be better.
Yeah, right? Exactly. We'll right. It's gonna be better.
How do you know this place even exists?
I was born there.
So why'd you leave?
I didn't. I was taken as a child. Stolen.
You've done this before?
Many times. Now that I drive a war rig, this is the best shot I'll ever have.
And then?
They're looking for hope.
What about you?
Redemption.
Victims of abuse need hope and redemption. And redemption, not in the classical sense, because if you're a victim of abuse, you're not guilty.
You haven't done anything wrong.
You haven't done anything wrong, including the things that you didn't want to do that are against your values. That is on the person who manipulated, controlled, threatened, abused you into doing things that are terrible. But redemption is not just from our own mistakes. It's also from the evil that's been done to us. Finding hope, finding a newness of life.
Sure.
I wanted to talk to you, Dr. Walker, about the importance of opening up. Now, Max is not a therapist. He is the farthest thing from a therapist I can think of. And yet it is powerful to have a listening ear.
I've said this a lot, I guess, since I've been in the media spotlight, but I deal with anxiety and depression. I actually just came from the dentist, and the dentist was like, "You've been grinding your teeth," which is something that's kind of new. I've been on medication. I've done all these things. And I will say that I am still kind of, personally, I'm still kind of therapy averse. And I think a lot of that is because I'm in a lot of ways afraid to hear to hear things that I've gone through. Like, I'm afraid to get it out of my body, but in fact, that's really what needs to happen. And so when I've had patients, I say to them, I'm like, you know, you may feel ashamed of these things, or you may feel like, you know, oh, it's, you know, it happened in the past. It's fine. Having that pain be exposed is, like you said, it's like, well, I may have engaged in things that I didn't want to do because my abuser wanted for me to do it. And so therefore I'm complicit. And I always say to, you know, to victims, I'm like, but you're not complicit. Like, you didn't.
Yeah.
Who would ever put themselves in this situation? In fact, you were doing what you felt you had to do in order to survive.
There's another side of this for some people, in that their abuser goes out of their way to make sure that the victim has a pleasurable experience, because then it murkies the water even further. I once talked with somebody who said, you know, my abuser manipulated me into doing all sorts of things that I didn't truly want to do and were against, you know, who I am. But then they made sure that it felt good. And then I felt complicit, like I felt like I was a willing party. And even for a while, where I would seek that out, because that's the behavior pattern that I'm locked in now. And only with distance from it do I realize, no, that's not who I wanted to be, and that's not what I wanted to be doing. But again, if it's used as a tool against you, if it's used as a tool to control you, you're not at fault. You're not guilty. This is part of what happens when people are manipulative abusers.
Yeah.
And the redemption is not from your guilt. It's from what's been done to you to find a different, a better life. But she was fighting to get them to basically Eden.
Yeah.
And Eden no longer exists. And so often, like, if I can just get past this hurdle, if I can just get to this place, then I can have the life I want. And what if that happens? How do you endure?
And this sequence right here of her wandering off into the dunes and the dust blowing across her, the sand blowing across her, that was actually Charlize Theron's idea.
Oh yeah?
That wasn't scripted, that wasn't storyboarded. She pitched that to George Miller as something, I'd really like to do this for my character. This is what Furiosa is going through. To have someone pitch you an idea that is so different from everything else that's happened in this hyperkinetic film, and he just immediately was like, yep, great. The sun goes down in 20 minutes. We're going to shoot it right before the sun goes down. So, like, get ready. We're going right over there.
It's one thing to get your feelings out. It's another thing to actually know that you're not alone. And it's such a validating experience, because when you're a victim, like, your abuser is cutting you off. And your abuser is actually making you feel like, our situation is unique, right? Like, well, you're not like those other people that were abused, because, like you were saying before, like, you know, well, you didn't want to do this thing that I wanted for you to do, but you actually enjoyed it. So you're actually not being abused, right?
Yeah.
And so when you hear from, like, other people, especially, like, all at one time, like, you went through that, like, I went through the same thing. And it's like, oh, you know what? Like, and it doesn't diminish, but it actually, like, that actually does bring about strength. Cause it's like, wow, I'm really not alone. Like, I felt so alone. I was willing to go back to this person. I was willing to do things that there's no way in hell I should have been doing. And then you get to hear, like, just this sounding board, it's like an echo chamber of people who are like, I went through the same thing, like it, and it, like, you're going to be okay.
Yeah.
And there's things to look forward to, and you get to be safe.
It's always been a little difficult for me to see abuse victims going back to their abusers. It's like, why would you possibly do this? But, you know, I've struggled with addiction for a long time, and my addiction, if I contextualize it this way, is my abuser, right? I kept going back to a thing that was hurting me.
Yeah.
But right. I liked it.
But you knew it.
I knew it. I knew it was going to hurt me. I knew it was going to feel good. So I did it anyway. And I knew that I wasn't the person that I wanted to be. And it's just like, I'd never put that together before, that like being an abuse survivor is in a lot of ways just like being an addict.
You hit the nail right on the head. It is. Yeah. It's just that the cycle is within you.
Yeah. My abuser was inside me.
Right.
It was the voice inside me telling me to do things. It wasn't a voice outside me telling me to do things and threatening to hurt me.
As a man, I love the moment where they say,
"The men, who are they?"
"They're reliable. They helped us get here."
I just wanted to have a brief conversation about what role can men have in the healing process, or should we just stay out of it altogether and let the women, you know, do it together? Obviously, there are men who are victimized by women. Obviously, it's not, but I'm just talking about the broad trends.
In this case, let's talk about, you know, female victims who are in heterosexual abusive relationships. I think it's really important to be able to have them be exposed, A, to a male, but also get feedback from that male when they do start to engage in behaviors that they know. Like you said, like, here's a male who I'm assuming is heterosexual and has a penis. Let me try to seduce him because that's what I need. That's what I know how to do. Or that's what I was taught to do. And I think it's really important for the male to, like you said, to be like, no, that's actually not why I'm here. I don't abide by that. And it's not about blaming the victim, but it is about saying, like, when it comes to healthy relationships, these are the boundaries.
Yeah.
And your relationships previously had no boundaries.
Yeah.
Not one boundary could be found. And it's important for that victim to then be able to see, like, oh, you know what? Boundaries are good. Because when that victim is trying to seduce the male therapist, let's say, she's just giving into, well, you know, this is just how things work. And it's like, no, relationships involve respect, and they involve boundaries, and they involve being able to have difficult conversations so that we get to actually strengthen our bond, our relationship, and it's not sexual.
And I think for a lot of people, they say, well, how can I tell, you know, the decent people from the wolves in sheep's clothing? And by and large, it's boundaries. People who set up boundaries tend to be the people that you can trust.
All right. This is your way home.
We go back?
Back?
Yeah.
He's like, girl, I'm not about to go back.
I just love that delivery. I thought you weren't insane anymore.
What's there to find at the Citadel?
Green.
And water. There's a ridiculous amount of clear water. And a lot of crops.
It's got everything you need. As long as you're not afraid of heights.
Where does the water come from?
He pumps it up.
So we can, now we've got the main point, we can talk over this a little bit. I want to talk, while this is playing, about the importance of facing things instead of running from them. Because they were just going to keep going on into the desert. They were going to flee. And Max is saying, turn and face it. Right?
There
is
go straight through it.
Go straight through it. Which is great for action, an action movie.
For sure, yeah.
So we take the war rig and we charge it right through the middle of them. We can decouple the tanker at the pass.
Is that good for therapy, though? I mean, I would assume that's on a case by case, right? You don't always want to just charge right into fixing your problem.
I don't know about charging right into it, but I do think you do need to get there. That some people just want to cut it loose and pretend it never happened. And I've yet to see the case where that was a good idea, where that wouldn't come back and bite them in a major way later. In large part because you find your power by facing it. Dr. Walker, what do you think?
No, I agree. I, I was actually thinking when you were saying what you just said, and I was agreeing with you, that when I've had patients, like it's kind of like when you, like, let's say you're an AA and, but you don't complete like the last step.
There's nothing but
sweat. And so there is a possibility that you would have to like you might make a mistake and you have to go back and you have to like repeat a step. And you, like when you really face what the actual issue is, or when you face like the actual threat, whether it be the person or the situation, your perspective, because you've done the work, has shifted and changed so much. But that by the time you actually face the actual threat, you realize in a lot of ways that the threat, like the person really wasn't as strong as you thought they were.
Right.
It's just that you were not in the best place, and that's why they preyed upon you.
Yeah.
And in some ways I have to tell patients, like, I don't want for you to then blame yourself, because like, oh, it's like, oh, like this person, like, ugh, like whatever. But it's more about seeing the fact that all this like change and dynamism took place. And it's like, you're a dynamic person. Like, look how far you've come. And now you can go back and look at this situation and look at this person and be like, oh my God, like you are such a weakling. Like, look how like small you are and infinitesimal you are compared to where I am now.
Yes, like abusers can be scary and physically threatening, and there is, you know, in some cases there's very real reason to fear. But you're talking about stepping into your power, and about how the reason you were so dominated is because they made you afraid and they made you doubt your power. And at a certain point you look at the person who hurt you and you see them as pathetic, and you see them as beneath you, you know, and that is so incredible. I love when Knox says,
feels like hope. Together. Come across some kind of redemption.
You find that after sexual abuse, I mean, I don't advocate just like going straight full charge into, let's open up all these memories and just deal with them. But having someone to help guide you through it, someone trained in trauma, someone who knows what they're doing, having a support of people who've been there. There are therapy groups for this sort of thing. If your family and friends can't relate, there are people who have walked where you're walking and who are further along in their journey than you, who can help you along, and then you can turn around and do the same thing in reverse. And just how crucial it is to open up, to find your strength, and to recognize that detachment and survival may feel like the safe play. And that's okay in the short term, but in the long term, for you to heal and to take the reins of your life again, you're going to have to find people you can trust. And how do you know if you can trust them? Because they either draw boundaries or they respect and honor yours.
This is a perfect film. Watch this movie. Enjoy this movie. Love this movie.
Dr. Walker, I want to thank you for being on the show. Where can people find you? Where can they follow you?
First of all, thank you so much for having me. This was super fun. And if you guys want to find me online, you can literally type in Dr. Imani Walker or Dr. Imani. I should pop up. And my website is doctor, which is doctor-imani, imani.com. You can also find me on Instagram, which is at dr.imani.com. Again, doctor, the whole word. And I have a podcast that is just basically me talking about mental health and being goofy and just kind of demystifying just mental illnesses and talking about pop culture stuff. And that's called Imani State of Mind. And that is on all platforms, all anywhere you can listen to a podcast. Just type in Imani State of Mind and you'll find me there.
So until next time,
I thought you weren't insane anymore.
Out here, everything hurts.
Pick up what you can and run.
And watch movies.
Nice.